fascinating about the protein signaling in macrophages and its role in atherosclerosis protection. So I'll begin by acknowledging that the work I'm going to talk about today is mainly work done by Pei Yu and Leticia Gonzalez, who are PhD students in my lab. And this work was started by Aisha Al-Jarala, a former PhD student, and Yi Zhang, while he was a postdoc in that. So atherosclerosis is a pathological thickening of the walls of medium and large-sized arteries that is a major cause of cardiovascular disease, so heart attacks and strokes. And this is an image of an atherosclerotic coronary artery from a human. And this is the normal thickness of the artery wall. And as you can see in this section, the artery wall is severely thickened, such that the lumen of the artery is only about around 20% of the normal size of the lumen. And this process, this pathological thickening of the wall, is driven by the accumulation of cholesterol derived from lipoproteins, mainly low-density lipoproteins, in the artery wall. So these can enter the artery wall, become trapped. They can then become chemically modified, for example, oxidized. And this creates a signal that activates the endothelium, causing recruitment of monocytes, which enter the artery wall, differentiating the macrophages. And then the macrophages engulf these oxidized lipids and accumulate very large amounts of cholesterol. These cholesterol-loaded macrophages secrete additional cytokines. They also secrete enzymes that oxidize the lipoproteins. And so this process is self-perpetuating with continual recruitment of monocytes and differentiation of the macrophages and continual entrapment of the lipoproteins and their oxidation. And as the macrophages accumulate large amounts of cholesterol in this region, they undergo cell death because accumulation of cholesterol within cells induces endoplasmic reticulum stress and triggers apoptosis. And this contributes to the formation of a region in the atherosclerotic plaque called the cell-free lipid-rich necrotic core. And this can be recognized in sections by the appearance of these clefts. This is actually the result of the accumulation of large amounts of extracellular cholesterol derived from these dead macrophages. And this cholesterol actually crystallizes within the tissue and can be recognized by these clefts. Now, very large lipid-rich cell-free necrotic cores contribute to a process called plaque instability or plaque rupture. And this is the rupture of the luminal surface of the atherosclerotic plaque, allowing access of the coagulation machinery to the contents of the plaque, which is a very thrombogenic environment. And so this then precipitates a thrombus formation, which occludes what little remains of the lumen of the artery. When this happens in an artery feeding the heart, the result is a heart attack. If it happens in an artery feeding the brain, the result is certain types of stroke. So this atherosclerosis process is driven both by inflammation as well as accumulation of lipoproteins. And two important factors that are associated with risk for coronary heart disease are low-density lipoprotein, or LDL, and high-density lipoprotein, or HDL. These are the two major cholesterol-carrying lipoproteins in human blood. And LDL is indeed referred to as the bad cholesterol because it accumulates in the artery wall and drives this process. Whereas HDL is called the good cholesterol because high levels of HDL in blood are associated with reduced risk of atherosclerosis. So these lipoproteins share a common general structure, which consists of a hydrophobic core of neutral lipid, mainly cholesterol esters and some triglycerides, surrounded by a shell of phospholipids, a monolayer of phospholipids, with unesterified cholesterol embedded in it. And then snaking around the lipoprotein are apolipoproteins, the protein component. So LDL contains a single apolipoprotein B100, which is greater than 500 kilodalton protein, a very large protein. And HDL contains a variety of apolipoproteins, the major one being a protein called apolipoprotein A1. But the structure and composition of HDL is much more complex than this simple picture. And in the past decade, various omics approaches, proteomics and lipidomics, have shown that these HDL particles are really a very heterogeneous class of particles. So greater than 8 proteins have been associated with HDL in proteomic studies. These include a variety of apolipoproteins. The major one is APOA1, but there are a variety of additional apolipoproteins associated. Enzymes involved in lipid metabolism are carried by the HDL particles. Components of complement regulation, the acute phase response, protease inhibitors. And lipidomics have shown hundreds of lipid species associated with HDL, including steroids, glycolipids, phospholipids, lysophospholipids, including a lipid called sphingosine monophosphate, which I'll talk a bit about, and a variety of lipid cycle vitamins. Even microRNAs have been reported to be associated with HDL particles. So what this demonstrates, first of all, is that there's such a variety of proteins, lipids, and other components associated with this particle that's between 150 and 300 kilodalton. So any given particle is too small to accommodate all of these components. And this indicates that HDL really is a heterogeneous collection of particles with different composition, and this composition is very dynamic. So this has led to the idea that really the amount of cholesterol associated with HDL is not what clinicians should be looking at in terms of estimating risk for heart disease, but rather HDL function. And this slide illustrates what has been considered for a number of years to be the major function of HDL in protection against cardiovascular disease. And that is a process called reverse cholesterol transport. So it illustrates a lipid-loaded macrophage in the RB wall. These are the endothelial cells that separate it from the blood, and then liver hepatocytes. So it's been known for a number of years that HDL, or its precursors, APOA1, can stimulate the efflux of excess cholesterol from the lipid-loaded macrophages. And the HDL can then cross into the blood and carry this cholesterol to the liver, where it interacts with receptors that selectively take up the lipid portion of the HDL particle and lead to deposition of secretion of cholesterol into the body. And this process, the net movement of excess steroids from the artery wall to the liver for biliary excretion, is the main route for the elimination of excess steroids from the body. But research over the past decade has also shown that HDL can elicit signaling pathways, can stimulate signaling pathways in cells. And this has been mainly studied in endothelial cells in a number of labs. And these signaling pathways lead to activation of ENOS and various other endothelial protective pathways and suppression of endothelial cell activation. We, however, have been interested in macrophage responses to HDL and in pathways that control the activation of apoptosis in macrophages and contribution to necrotic proliferation. So to begin to study this, we took primary macrophages from mice, these are thylakoid-glycolated primary macrophages, put them into culture in full serum, and then treated them with ER stress-inducing agents, because endoplasmic reticulum stress markers are abundant in macrophages in atherosclerotic plaques, and because endoplasmic reticulum stress is known And so we measured apoptosis using an XM5 tunnel staining in this experiment. And we saw that these macrophages, cultured macrophages, were very resistant to apoptosis when they were cultured in whole serum. However, when we removed the lipoproteins from the serum and cultured them in the absence of lipoproteins, they became much more sensitive to PR stress and induced apoptosis. So Pei Yu in my lab was interested in identifying the lipoproteins that could confer this protection, and so she added back either purified human HDL or LDL to the culture medium and found that HDL could suppress the ER stress induced apoptosis, but LDL could not. Yi Zhang in the lab was interested in the molecular pathways by which HDL might induce protection against apoptosis, and he surveyed a variety of apoptosis regulators and found that treatment of macrophages with HDL led to reductions in the amount of the pro-apoptotic protein BIM. So BIM promotes apoptosis by negatively regulating inhibitors of apoptosis. So when BIM levels are low, these inhibitors of apoptosis are free to inhibit this pathway. We wanted to know how the cells were responding to HDL. And we focused on this protein called the scavenger receptor class B1, which is a high-affinity receptor for HDL that's known to bind HDL and allow for bidirectional transport of lipids, exchange of lipids between HDL and the cell membrane. But research has also implicated this receptor in signaling in response to HDL. So we looked at macrophages' response of macrophages from mice that either express this receptor or were knocked out of this receptor, and found that wild-type macrophages were protected by HDL against ER stress and induced apoptosis, but SRB1-deficient macrophages could not be protected by HDL. We were also interested in what component of the HDL particle might confer this protection. And I mentioned sphingosine-1 phosphate as a bioactive lipid that's carried by HDL. We wanted to determine if sphingosine-1 phosphate in HDL was conferring this protection. So we treated HDL with an enzyme called sphingosine-1 phosphate lyase. And this enzyme cleaves the head group from sphingosine-1 phosphate inactivated. So we treated HDL with sphingosine-1 phosphate lyase. And while control-treated HDL could protect cells against apoptosis, S1P lyase-treated HDL lost its ability to protect macrophages from apoptosis, implicated sphingosine-1 phosphate in this protective effect. So this and other experiments led us to this working model for the signaling pathway. HDL binding to SRB1 signals through the sphingosine-1 phosphate cargo of HDL, activating sphingosine-1 phosphate receptors, which are gene protein coupled receptors. And we've also knocked out sphingosine-1 phosphate receptor 1 and shown that it's the receptor that's involved in the signaling pathway. It's known to be upstream of PI3 kinase and AKT. Inhibiting PI3 kinase or knocking out AKT1 also prevents HDL-induced protection against apoptosis. And this leads to reduction of BIM, which leads to reduction of apoptosis in cells in vitro. So we were interested in determining whether this might contribute to attenuating necrotic core formation and plaque instability in vivo. And to do this, we turned to the mouse's model system, and we generated atherosclerosis-prone APOE knockout mice, whose macrophages could not respond to HDL by transplanting those mice with bone marrow from mice lacking SRB1. And as controls, we transplanted other mice, APOE knockout mice, with bone marrow from mice expressing SRB1. We then looked at atherosclerotic plaques in these animals and stained those plaques for BIM. and showed that the level of immunofluorescence of BIM was much higher in plaques from mice that lack S71 in macrophages than mice that express S71 in macrophages. And this is quantified here. We also looked at apoptosis in the atherosclerotic plaques by tunnel staining, and found that there were much more apoptotic nuclei in atherosclerotic plaques from mice lacking SRP1 in macrophages than those from mice expressing SRP1 in macrophages. And indeed, there were much larger areas that were devoid of nuclei, suggesting increased necrotic core formation in plaques in mice that lack SRP1 in macrophages compared to that express SRP1. So this then suggests that HDL, in addition to its role in removing cholesterol from plaques and stimulate signaling pathways in macrophages that lead to protection against apoptosis, and that this may contribute to an ability of HDL to attenuate the formation of necrotic cores and contribute to plaque stability. So this identifies a new role for HDL in protection against cardiovascular disease, and perhaps suggests new biomarkers, for example, sphingosine phosphate carried by HDL in order to assess risk for atherosclerosis in clinical settings. So with that, I'll stop. And I'll be happy to take questions.
Any questions? You know, how much of sphingosine phosphate is specific? Carried with HDL related to LDL in terms of S1PR receptor activation?
So, sphingosine 1 phosphate certainly is found in multiple lipoprotein fractions. It's also present in outside of lipoproteins carried by other proteins. So, that's a good question. In terms of the amount. That can vary. What our data suggests, as well as data from others looking at this signal, is that the sphingosine 1 phosphate carried by HDL has different effects on cells than sphingosine 1 phosphate added in other ways. So it may be that that you know there is sphingosine 1 phosphate carried in a variety of lipoproteins, but something specific related to the HDL affects its outcome. And that could be related to the receptor for HDL localizing the source of sphingosine 1 phosphate in close proximity to a specific receptor, sphingosine 1 phosphate receptor 1. And one of the things that I didn't mention is this adaptive protein, PDZK1. This is a protein that contains four protein-protein interaction domains that binds to the carboxy terminus of SRP1. And two of these interaction domains have been shown to interact with SRP1, but what the other two protein-protein interaction domains interact with has not been identified. So we've shown that this is absolutely necessary for HDL signaling in these cells. And one possibility is that this might localize SRP1 in close proximity to this receptor. This is pure speculation at this point, but certainly something that we're going to be looking at.
Thank you.
Very nice. So, do you have any evidence from GWAS studies that this pathway, you know, carries variants that would affect people's propensity to develop cardiac disease?
So, so the GWAS studies have mainly looked at associations between HDL cholesterol levels and coronary artery disease. And those studies have come to the conclusion that that SNPs that are related with changes in HDL cholesterol levels do not appear to correlate with cardiovascular disease. Now, there are some studies looking at specific polymorphisms in some of these components, and in particular SRP1, that have shown that certain polymorphisms in SRP1 that appear to lower levels of expression are associated with increased coronary artery disease.